unprecedented times, and I clearly would have hoped to not be providing the kind of information that I'm going to be providing this afternoon. But it is what it is, and we will manage through it. This was a report filed by the New York Times based on Johns Hopkins University data. I believe this was reported Thursday of last week, in which the New York Times compared all 50 states to all the countries in the world in regards to their numbers of COVID positive patients within the last 2 weeks per million residents of that particular state or country. And unfortunately, South Carolina has come up number three on that list behind Arizona and Florida. A few days ago, we heard that Florida had had 15,000 cases in 1 day. South Carolina, I believe, had over a weekend at least 1 day where we were at 2,600 or 2,700. I believe those numbers have continued to increase. Those are uniquely high numbers and are reflected in what is happening throughout our community, not just in the state of South Carolina, but in the upstate and the Spartanburg, Cherokee, and Union communities specifically. There is no doubt, absolutely no doubt, that this is one of the worst hotspots in the country, and we have a serious crisis on our hands. This was statewide data published by DPEC last Thursday, July 9th. I'm drawing attention to the percent positive rate. That was 20.6%. Those were of all people who were tested within the state of South Carolina. That would include inpatient and outpatient. So anyone who was tested, that data was 20.6%. Those numbers have since increased to approximately 23% statewide. The local data in Spartanburg community has also reflected that, and I believe that at our last look we were around 22%. So we're closely tracking the statewide numbers. The reason that that's particularly important is to compare it to before Memorial Day. When we look back to the time before Memorial Day, before the reopening of businesses and general community activities, that percent positive rate was as low as about 4 or 5%. So it has gone up dramatically. And as that number increases, the number of expected people who will require hospitalization and hospital care continues to go up. And that is reflected in our hospitalizations. Our local data, again, this was just a web nugget that I pulled off, worse than New York. South Carolina is certainly hitting the news media now as a hotspot amongst the rest of the country. These are numbers from the DPEC website as of last week. Those dark blue areas on the South Carolina map reflect the hotspots in South Carolina. And as expected, they are primarily in the denser populated areas of the state, the Greenville-Spartanburg area, the Columbia area, the Charleston area, which of course makes perfect sense. In terms of reported cases, this gives you some indication of the rapid rise since approximately Memorial Day. We were relatively flat as you can see, those numbers remain the same for several weeks and then have just shot up enormously. The other interesting point here is the average age of positive tests has dropped from in the mid-50s to about 41, and that's partly reflective of the fact that there's greater testing availability throughout the state and in our local region as well. And so folks who back in March and April just would not have been tested can now get tests, and so that does bring that number down a little bit. But again, the sheer volume of positive tests is really going through the roof. This is another graph of the recent spike. The orange are the what we call PUIs, the persons under investigation within the hospital. The blue are the patients who are COVID positive within the hospital. And to give you some reference point, back at the low portion when things were feeling pretty good. We had approximately 10 or so patients on any given day who were COVID positive. Last week, we were in the low 60s. As of today, we're at 75. The demographics of the people who have tested positive has also changed. We are seeing a younger population that, again, as reopening of activities has occurred, we're now seeing more people getting tested and more people testing positive. So that younger age group is reflected there. I think it's also interesting to point out that the older age group is not testing positive in as high a degree as they were previously. And that is, I believe, mostly reflective of the fact that they are adhering to our recommendations, staying home, wearing masks, washing their hands, maintaining physical distance, and avoiding activities that would have lots of large congregations of people where they would put themselves at risk. Not included on this slide, but the South Carolina Hospital Association has an algorithm that they're using now to give some idea of your risk in terms of if you go out and you're amongst 10 people or 50 people or 100 people, what might be your risk of one of those people in the room having COVID? And to put it mildly, if there are 10 people in the room and you're in the Spartanburg or Greenville areas, you've got approximately a 30% chance that at least one of the people in that room is COVID positive. If you've got a larger group of people, then that percentage of potential COVID positives increases dramatically. And clearly, as you put yourself at risk in larger and larger groups of people, the likelihood of you contracting the illness also goes up. This is a slide reflecting the race distribution in South Carolina. This is DHEC data, again, as of last week. 46% white, 32% black, and you can see the dispersion for the rest. If there's any good news in this, it's that the percent positive for black population has gone down from approximately 40% to 32%, but is still not in any way reflective of the overall population of the state. Unfortunately, the minority population is still overrepresented when it comes to COVID. Testing is an ongoing evolution for us. We have three current sites in Cherokee, Union, and Spartanburg. We have worked to make those permanent sites as the realization has set in that this pandemic is not going away anytime soon. And so those sites are now safer for our staff, safer for the citizenry who come through for those tests, and we hope are also more efficient. We're currently running approximately 400 people per day through those testing sites, and I imagine that will continue to increase. The turnaround time for tests that we have to send out, and those send-outs are still primarily going to DHEC or LabCorp, those take about 4 to 5 days. As the testing throughout the state has increased, those third parties or DHEC have also struggled to keep up with the sheer volume of tests and getting those results back to whoever ordered them. There have been a variety of supply chain disruptions, and we anticipate that will continue. One of those we experienced a couple of weeks ago in relation to reagent for our in-house testing machine. We were able to, fortunately for us, we were able to quickly ramp up with not only DHEC, but also some local vendors who've been able to pick up the slack for us and being able to ensure relatively rapid turnaround time for our inpatients of less than 12 hours. We have experienced local outbreaks both within nursing homes and prison. Again, in any area where there are large congregate settings, fully expect that this will continue. I will congratulate the nursing homes and the long-term facilities in that they have really done an exceptional job of reducing risk for their vulnerable populations. And despite the scattered outbreaks, for the most part, we have not had any tragic outbreaks, and so we continue to support their efforts. On a community side, we continue to work with local schools, colleges, businesses, political leaders, and really anyone else who's interested to create, support, and maintain safe strategies for fighting this pandemic. The emphasis remains the simple measures, and I have said many of these things many, many, many times. There's no special sauce to this. There's no magic when it comes to preventing the spread of this virus. The key here is to do the things that we know that reduce risk, and those are wearing masks, practicing effective hand hygiene, maintaining physical distancing whenever, wherever you can, disinfecting your common areas frequently, and sticking to those. If we do that, we will reduce risk. We can't get rid of this virus, but we can reduce the risks and therefore reduce the transmission throughout the community.
Chris, I think it's worth emphasizing that. I wonder if anyone else saw this report I saw yesterday. There was a salon in Missouri where two of the hairstylists were positive. They serviced 130 clients. Both the employees and all the clients wore masks, and none of the 130 got it, even though the two were positive. Masks work.
That's right.
Very simple.
The masks work. Yeah. There is no doubt about that. Healthcare workers throughout the country and throughout the world have been using PPE very effectively. For the most part, unless we break those precautions, we have remained safe, and it works. If there's one message for the community, I would hope that they would listen, and that's wear the masks. Wear the masks, and wear the masks. They do work. Continuing that, we are working on a variety of, along with the community outreach, the schools, the colleges, what can they do to be successful this year? And I think the key to success is flexibility and adaptability. There is no doubt that we are going to have disruptions. We're having them now, we will have them in the future. And so the ability of these institutions to think quickly on their feet, to keep their associates or students safe, and to be flexible in terms of their work policies will be key. Most of us by now, and some of us even here, we've done lots of tele-meetings, we've done lots of web-based education or learning. Schools will certainly be employing those modalities for their students. And from a medical perspective, the use of telemedicine is truly growing at a truly exponential rate throughout the country. I mentioned this, and I've already mentioned the update. This was from last week. At the time, we had 60 positive patients, and we're now up to 75. The PUI, that's an abbreviation for persons under investigation, 20 last week. When I put together this presentation today, we had 29. So it does reflect the ongoing spread throughout our local community, which is now spilling over into the hospitals. We have an expansion and surge plan that we have been activating step by step by step. We're in a relatively good position, as I've said before, because of the ability to move patients throughout our system. But clearly, this will put a strain on any healthcare system, wherever it happens to be. We have canceled elective surgeries. We've moved surgeries, when possible, to other campuses. And we're doing a variety of other things to manage through the stress that this puts on our system. This is also just a DHEC slide to give some indication of what happens following hospitalization. And about 89%, as reported by DHEC, will recover following hospitalization. As we know, the data on the vulnerable patients, and by vulnerable, that can includes anyone of advanced age and anyone who has significant comorbid conditions, those folks are most likely to have a worse outcome. And then lastly, future concerns. These are the things we're working on now and will be for the, certainly the near and certainly the longer term future as well. As the cases continue to rise, it affects not just the patients, not just the community, the folks who are seeking care. It also begins to take its toll on the physical and mental health of our team, whether that be the physicians, the nurses, the respiratory therapists, the lab technicians, the administrators, whomever it is, this will take its toll. What we are beginning to see are some of our associates whose children perhaps catch COVID and they have to remain at home to provide care. We are seeing associates who may have to leave because of the daycare closure. We anticipate that in the future we may have issues with school closures and that's effect on our staff. So we have put into place and continue to evaluate and work through a variety of plans to help our staff to continue to work and provide the care that we need to provide. I think it's also important to say that while we have a surge in COVID patients, we also continue to take care of a very large number of people who have nothing related to COVID. So the ordinary illnesses continue to happen, the traumas continue to happen, the heart attacks continue to happen, the strokes continue to happen, and preventative care continues to need to be done. So we are acting on that front as well to maintain that high quality throughout all of this and maintain access to care as we work through these challenges. I mentioned before that we're working very closely with many of the local schools and colleges. They have put together a variety of plans. I know they have different timetables for announcing those, and so we'll leave it to them to do that. But clearly, they are going to be extraordinarily challenged this year, and we do anticipate that there will be quite a few starts and stops as the year progresses. Mr. Chairman, that concludes my report. Happy to take any questions if there are any.
Thank you, Dr. Lombardosi. At this time, I'll turn it over to Dr. Morrow for the Gill Clinic and Residency.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.